Hey guys, welcome to another episode of the Ripple Podcast. My name is Allie Lang. Ripple Podcast was started so that we could highlight the work that God's done in the lives of men and women who have battled addiction and seen recovery, as well as the wives who come alongside the men who have battled their addiction. And so today I'm excited to sit down with Gina. Gina has been through our Enrich program. It's a program that comes alongside of the women, the wives of the men in the colony. And so she's going to share a little bit of her story with us. So tell me a little bit about your life growing up.
I was brought up and raised Catholic. Mm-hmm. So I even went to Catholic school all the way up through sixth grade. So like I always like to say, when you go to Catholic mass, you have everything memorized because it's all the same every time. Mm-hmm. So the only thing that's really different is the gospel part. So like I knew every prayer, every possible, but I didn't know God growing up. And so besides that, that was an area. So I've always had God in my life and Jesus in my life, but I didn't know the relationship I could have with them. Our family was very family oriented. We always did huge family parties with all my cousins and aunts. Always saw my grandparents every weekend. Basically, when that all changed is when my grandparents passed away. Mm-hmm. Everybody just went their own way. We stepped out of the church. I don't know why my parents did. I never really brought that up because communication with my parents, I never really developed a communication with them, like in that sense, mm-hmm. to go deeper. It was just something that just happened. So I would say probably from the time of 20 till I met John, church was not a part of my life besides for funerals or weddings.
Right. So tell me a little bit how you met John and what attracted you to him.
Okay, so funny story is, I'm a teacher. So before I became a teacher, I was a teacher's assistant and his mom and his sister worked in the same school. Mm-hmm. And I was invited to his sister's wedding. And that's where we met at her bachelorette party, because her bachelorette party and her husband's bachelor party were the same night and we all traveled together, but the guys went their way, the girls went their way. And that night, we wound up staying up all night talking, mm-hmm. the whole night talking. And that's kind of what attracted me to him, that every time, the first, I would say, month or two, we would always just have nice conversations. Mm-hmm. I felt appreciated. I felt loved. Mm-hmm. So those are areas that I never felt before. Mm-hmm. So I thought that that's definitely is one area that attracted me to him. Another area is that he is outgoing, so he's willing to try things that are new. And I'm so reserved that I don't like anything new. Uh-huh. None of the ones ever. I like the routine. I know routine has to change, but like afraid of heights and all that stuff. And he got me to do certain things like that. So that was cool.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome. So John has an addiction though. Tell me a little bit about how that presented itself in your marriage and what your reaction was to that.
Okay, so when we first met, he was sober. I don't know how long he was sober. I just know he was sober at that time. I didn't know of his past. And he had an addiction issue, but I thought when he was sober that that has changed.
Right.
Slowly, I saw behaviors changing. He would distance himself, he would spend more time to himself and not so much time with me, or if we were together, he'd be rushing to leave.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't know per se what addiction he had. I just knew his behaviors changed until he would use in front of me or stuff like that. And that definitely threw me for a loop. Mm-hmm. For that, unfortunately, addiction I know too well, because my brother had an addiction issue. So from the time I was 15 or 16, I dealt with it. So I knew that was like about it.
Mm-hmm.
But John's addiction was different than my brother's. So two different addictions. So it was kind of hard to say I knew how long he was or how into the addiction he was until it got too caught up. And at that point, I thought I could fix him.
Right.
I thought love could fix him. I thought mm-hmm. I can give him what he wants or he needs and that would stop it, but it never did, unfortunately.
Right. So how did he end up at the Colony of Mercy?
Okay, so when John entered the colony for the first time in 2017, we were separated for 5 years.
Mm-hmm.
His addiction got so bad that I had to separate for the girl's sake because we have two daughters. So. I guess the addiction took a heat. Like we would stay in contact because of the girls, but I really didn't know how bad the addiction was until I got a call from his mom that he overdosed so bad that he had a seizure.
Mm-hmm.
And he was in the hospital for 3 weeks. While he was at the hospital, I did visit him a couple times, and there was an ICU nurse that was a blessing. She would pray over him. she's the one that actually mentioned Keswick to him. And I don't know how it transpired, to be honest. I just know he filled out the application and he was accepted. And when he came back from the hospital, he had to stay at his mom's house for a couple weeks because he couldn't get in here right away. Mm-hmm. And he came, and when he was here the first time, he stayed for the discipleship program for the 8 months.
Mm-hmm. Right. Mm-hmm. So what was it like? I mean, you had already had a separation mm-hmm. from him, but what was it like being separated, knowing now that he was getting help while he was here?
Okay, so the first 4 months when John was in the colony, my goal was to work on me, and his goal was to work on him. So I didn't even know we were going to get back together mm-hmm. until after the 4 months, till I started to see change. Because mm-hmm. John went to secular rehabs many times through our relationship and in our marriage, like at least 4 times. So they're always, I always call it the honeymoon period. Mm-hmm. When he came home from a secular rehab, it would be like the first 4 months he was fine.
Right.
And then after that, so I saw change in him, but I really had to see change because I saw it before. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of what happened. It wasn't until really after the 4 month mark and he entered the discipleship program. Mm-hmm. That was really the key for me, to be honest, because that was really showing me that he was determined right. to make this work because mm-hmm. he made a commitment to stay here longer.
Right.
He wasn't ready. He knew he wasn't ready to leave yet. He still needed more help.
Right. Absolutely. And so while he was doing that, you were in the Enrich program.
That's correct.
Tell me what you expected from there and okay. what you received from there.
So when John told me that I was eligible for the Enrich program, I really was hesitant about it because I'm like, okay, he's here for him. Mm-hmm. And I don't even know if we're going to get back together or not. So I was hesitant. And then I'm like, I thought about it and I was like, okay, you know what? Why not? I can talk. I can get my emotions out. It doesn't have to be about him. It could be about like what I've been through, not about what he's going through currently. Mm-hmm. So I did. I accepted the offer and I met with Melissa Smith, and she was a godsend. Mm-hmm. She realized and showed me that his issues aren't my issues. I have my own baggage. Mm-hmm. And that's really what Enrich brought me, like to come and learn who I am. And actually I was saved here through Enrich, believe it or not. One counseling session in April. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was amazing. From that moment on, I've just been a changed person mm-hmm. from that moment on. So Enrich is definitely a blessing to me, not even just to my family, but to me personally.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So tell me a little bit about the reconciliation story, because okay. now you and John are back together.
Yes, absolutely. It happened, I guess he asked me if I would participate in FFC. And for the first four months, I said no. Finally in July, when he was in discipleship, I said yes. So we came. And that weekend, I don't know what it was, or something clicked. I don't know if it was during our counseling session or our private time, but like it was the first time he actually apologized. Mm-hmm. And for him to apologize for his role was huge. And that just like in my heart was like, wow, he's a changed man. Mm-hmm. Like if he can change this and he can continue this growth, then who knows what the Lord can bring both of us at this point. And it just kept getting better and better every time we came for FFC. Mm-hmm. So from July until September, we would come on the weekends, or we would do the FFC program and just continue to grow from there.
Right, that's so awesome. So tell me what's different about your relationship with him now because of everything you guys have been through.
Hi. What the key, to be honest, what's changed the most is that we do things together. Like I said, like I like to say before, he had his life, I had mine, mm-hmm. but we never were together in things. Like we never agreed on things, we never could come to an agreement. Where now that's changed. We're willing to go places together. If we go there out of love, we go there because we want to. We do Bible studies together, which is huge. Because John came through the colony twice. Mm-hmm. So the first time he was working on him and all, even when he came home, he was still working on him. So we still had a lot to work on together. Because mm-hmm. you have to think, we were separated for 5 years.
Right.
So like the first, when he was home, we would do things. We didn't really do Bible studies together the first time around. He did his thing, I did my thing once again. Mm-hmm. It was like definitely the second time, it's just where we built our relationship. We decided to do our covenant together. We're doing more like worship in the Lord together, where we didn't do that before.
Right.
Which is awesome.
Yeah, definitely. So undoubtedly there's somebody out there watching that has a loved one that's struggling in addiction. What would you say to that person?
First off, well, I like to say to everybody, pray first. If you are, even if you're not a believer, pray. Prayer is everything. And then another thing is to ask for help. It's okay to ask for help, even if you just talk to that one person, because you don't realize how many people out there might have an addiction like you, or not even addiction like you, or might know somebody that can reach out, because there's so much out there for you right now. It's just, and it, I don't realize, you never realize how much is out there for you until you actually say you have a problem or you know someone that has a problem.
Gina, I really appreciate you being willing share your story. If this story touched your heart, if you would be willing to share it for other people, the hope and prayer is that there would be a ripple effect, and the life change in one person would inspire change in other people as well. So we hope that you enjoyed this. We hope that you will share it, and you will tune in next time. Thank you.